everybody. It's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today is tomato planting day, along with some other vegetables, and maybe some plants, and maybe a couple of raspberries. But this is where it all began, with me showing my formula for planting tomatoes when you first begin.
Yeah, but you didn't want to do it.
No, I didn't. Plus, it was a little bit hotter that day. But anyway, I'm using a modified version of Jerry Baker's formula, and it starts with compost. So he suggests 3 cups of compost. Now I'm going to do a double batch, but I'll give you the individual batch measurements. Okay, so it's 3 cups of compost. This is a 2-cup. Okay, and since I'm doing a double batch, I'll just fill that up again.
So now you're going to confuse everybody.
No, it's going to be 3 cups of compost.
Okay.
1/2 cup of Epsom salts. That has magnesium in it. That's really good for plants. So 1/2 cup. But since I'm doing a double, I'm going to go right ahead. But remember, 1/2 cup. And 2 tablespoons of baking soda. Actually, I think it's 1 tablespoon. 1 tablespoon of baking soda I'm going to put in too. And you don't have to be totally... Let's finish that. This is for mold and mildew and... the fungus family. It helps get rid of those things in the soil.
Or deter them.
It deters them. Now, we've had many suggestions that we should perhaps be adding other things, such as peat moss, Tim. So I'm going to throw in a couple of good handfuls of peat moss.
And just so Tim knows, we do keep our peat moss
buckets.
And we have more buckets over there too, so.
Mm-hmm. So with this formula, what I will do after I get it all mixed together is dig the hole for the tomato, put this in the bottom of the hole, and then treat it just like any other planting of tomatoes. Except this year, in addition to adding the peat moss, I have been doing some research on azomite. The azomite comes from the western part of the United States. I believe that's where they got this group. It's the natural trace minerals, the things that plants need just a tiny bit of. And if they have those, they'll grow so much better. So it's not the quantity that we're putting on, it's just the trace of the minerals to get in there and supply the last key to the best crops you're ever going to plant. We'll see.
Now, do you put any vermiculite or perlite in there?
Nope. Because that's in the soil already. This just goes directly into the roots as I plant. Since we have 36 tomato plants that we're planting, this is probably not going to be enough. So I'm going to be making at least one more double batch.
I have a feeling you're going to make more than one more.
Remember, I only have to put a handful in, though.
I know.
It's not like I'm making 40,000 plants worth.
You might. I'll buy you some more tomato plants.
No, thank you, no.
You feel like a chemist?
I do. Of course I do every time I cook anyway, so.
Well, it is amazing how successful your tomatoes have been over the years.
Yeah. It is, and that's why I keep doing this.
Now, you have a lot of viewers who constantly ask about eggshells versus dried powdered milk.
I didn't even get to that part yet, but yes, I do.
I know. Did you want to address it now and then again later?
Surely. Okay. Another part of this formula is dry powdered milk that you sprinkle on after you have it planted. You don't sprinkle it on the plant, you sprinkle it around the ground, and that helps prevent blossom and rot. Now, some gardens have a more acidy soil, some have more lime soil, and if you have a more acidy soil, perhaps you need more alkaline, which is what this milk is, to help improve the intake of the calcium into the plant. That's what causes the blossom and rot. This helps with that, but it also helps with funguses and mildew and that sort of thing. And it just kind of protects your plant. I am going to knock on wood. We have never, ever had a fungus problem with our tomatoes. And I kind of give credit to this calcium from this dry milk. Now, some people say, well, how about eggshells? They're full of calcium, which they are, and I'm sure that helps a lot too, but I don't know if it has the same fungicide properties as the milk does. But it would be worth a try. If you have lots of eggshells and you just want to do a comparison, take the same kind of tomato plant, do one with eggshells and one with the powdered milk. That's the only way you're going to know. Finally, we're a little bit, a few days ahead of our time, except it's in the 80s now, so we decided we needed to get them in now since they've been sitting in pots all this time. But before we can do that, these are our invasive raspberries. We hate to just toss them into the compost bin, so we're going to pot some up, and if our friends or neighbors want some, they're welcome to them. But I need this space for my tomatoes. So my husband has been sweet enough to dig them. They have nice healthy roots on them. Last week we had our annual Master Gardener's plant sale, and I had potted some up to take there. They weren't quite this big, and they were probably one of the first plants to go.
They were very popular.
That and the bleeding hearts. People love the bleeding hearts.
Well, if nothing else, they'll have a chance to root themselves for the plant sale next year.
This is true.
It's amazing how they get into everything. I mean, even out into the strawberry patch. So we have to redo our strawberries now.
The root system is just amazing. And when people say they have trouble growing these, I just ponder, because they seem to grow like weeds.
But they are delicious.
They are.
Did you see the price of raspberries in the store the other day?
Oh, they're outrageous. Which, again, it just surprises me, because they are so easy to grow, and they grow in so many different climates, I would think. I mean, if they grow here.
I think if you went to a garden center for raspberry
plant
that size, you're going to probably be paying, what, maybe $5-6?
Oh, at least, yeah.
I mean, even those tiny ones that you had in the little pots, I mean, mm-hmm. those plants weren't more than 2 or 3 inches.
Right.
I mean, people were paying a couple bucks just for those.
Yep. Of course, they were for the plant sale.
True. So I'd say you've got at least a couple of dozen just in this little spot right here.
Yes, and they're really happy.
Yes.
I'm putting more than one in a pot.
There you go.
Is that movie line, "Be Nasty to Nasturtiums"?
From Silver Streak?
Mm-hmm. And my comment would be rough with raspberries.
There you go.
Now this is part of the reason. Last year I chopped all of the raspberries that were growing along the fence, but they left their roots and they paid me back by showing up.
I mean, they've traveled 20 feet.
Oh, at least, yes. Yep. These were the original raspberries.
And they're still trying to come up between the fence and the bed. When you say original raspberries, these were the ones that actually came with the property 40 some years ago.
Yes. Thank your mom, Jim.
Yep. Jim now is living in New Zealand.
Mm-hmm.
It's always interesting when he sends us a picture of the old house, you know, when it was one of the only homes in the area. I guess this used to be a horse farm,
mm-hmm.
which probably explains the great soil.
You saying horses left a lot of deposits here?
I'm saying I think they left a very healthy soil. Not that we haven't amended our soils accordingly over the years.
Right. Look at all this vermiculite in here.
And peat moss.
And peat moss.
So Woody?
And compost.
Tim, there is peat moss. Lots of it.
Okay, now all they need is some water and sunlight and they are on their way.
And now you can start planting tomatoes.
Finally.
Finally.
And so it begins. First off, dig your hole. Tomatoes are one of these plants that like to have their stem buried when they're planted. It makes them stronger because roots will come out of the stem, even though the leaves are on it now. The roots will come out of there. These have been staked when they were planted, so I'm going to unstake them.
And we should mention these are the tomato berry, which
are
so
ones we love.
Delicious. I mean, it's like popping candy in your mouth.
Mm-hmm. It is. It's just wonderful, and we've had really good luck with these plants, even when other things didn't do well. Now, we were teaching a class this spring, and one of our class members, and we always encourage people to tell us what they do because there's so much knowledge that people gain just from doing their own planting. And he said, don't touch the stems of the plants when you're planting them, which I always have done. But he said that they're very tender and instead you should pick them up by the leaves, actually. I don't know how that's going to work, but I'll give it a try. All right, so this is how it looks. I'm not going to disturb the roots too much, but if they are starting to go sideways, I'm going to just untangle them a little bit. And these are pretty stocky already, so I don't think I'm going to do too much sideways, but I will do a deeper hole.
Can you put it closer to the trellis system?
Well, I could, if that's where you want it. Okay, let me just measure. Yep, it's a little below grade. All right, now what I'm going to do is take a nice, generous handful of my mixture, put it down in there, and then Jerry Baker's secret is to put a little pinch of sugar in the bottom. Now, some people say, well, that's not going to make your plant any sweeter. No, it probably won't, but what it does is it feeds the nematodes that are helpful in your soil so that they will be happier and they will do their job better. So that goes in there. I didn't touch any stems. Press it down. And then I always like to make a little moat to catch the water when we sprinkle them, at least at the beginning. And then I'll take, but first I think I'll do the azomite. Now the azomite comes in granular form and they said just sprinkle a little bit, so I'm just going to take a pinch and I'm just going to sprinkle it around the edge. That's it. And then I should have opened this. Fingernail help, please. I'm just going to take a handful of milk, which doesn't want to come out. There you go. And just sprinkle it around the bottom. And last but not least, take the name of the plant you're planting and put it someplace next to it so you remember what it is, especially if this is your first time. Just as a recap, because I was getting things all thrown into the pot at the same time, it's 3 cups of compost. Make sure it's nice
aged
compost, 1/2 cup of Epsom salts, 1 tablespoon of baking soda, and mix it all together. Now this time I threw in some peat moss, so you can do that. If you have some worm castings, you could throw those in there. And then when you plant them, put a generous handful into the bottom of the hole, a little pinch of sugar, and then when you have it done, I'm using the azomite. If you don't have it, don't worry about it. And sprinkle it with dry milk. And then you're all set. Water and enjoy. Many times we rotate our crops because you don't want to grow the same family of crops in the same plot every year. Up here last year we planted beans and peas and cabbages and kale and
radishes.
Well, we did radishes
and garlic.
Garlic. And so this is now prime place to plant tomatoes, eggplants, and potatoes. Anything in that family can now go in here. And over in our other beds where we have done tomatoes in that family for a couple of years, those are all going to go up here, and the beans and the peas and the other things are going to go down in the other bed. And because of that, we have to configure our structure better, because we like to do vertical gardening as much as possible. We can't get our big tomato cages in here, so thanks to Betterbilt, we're using their trellis system, and we're going to be happy, and we'll just tie them up to this trellis.
Well, the other thing for first-time gardeners, you want to discuss determinant and indeterminate?
Yes, determinant means that the tomato will only grow so high. And those kinds of tomatoes are the Roma tomatoes. Roma tomatoes are not known for their height. All the fruit comes ready about the same time, and you need to do something with all of those right away. Indeterminate means they can go on and on and on, and that's what these tomato berries are, and many of the other tomato plants that you normally see. Those continue to grow throughout the season, and you can snip off the ends of them if they get too long. Don't be afraid to do that, and then they'll branch out a little bit more. But it's best if you can get them up off the ground. Your fruit will stay healthier. It'll be less likely to have insects sharing it with you. And also it aids in the airflow and keeps mildew and insects from getting a foothold in your plant. You don't want that.
Do you notice you're sitting on a pile of compost?
Mm-hmm. Very soft.
Thank all those cows.
Okay, I'm checking the roots. And what you could do sometimes is split the bottom a little bit and then make sure you plant it firmly into the soil. Just gives more contact also. Doesn't matter if you cover up some of the leaves.
I would say that leaf compost in fall really, really added to the soil.
Yes.
I mean, that is some nice, nice soil.
It's lovely.
And just for everyone's benefit, we've been taking a poll versus dirt versus soil. I still contend that dirt is something you sweep out or vacuum from your carpet and you don't want to grow food in it. But at this point, we're running about 2.5 to 1. 2.5 times more people will use the word dirt than they do soil.
But when you asked the master gardeners at the luncheon the other day, everyone but me said soil.
Yeah, well, like I said, I'd prefer to grow my food in soil.
All right, then we shall.
But that's just me. I like to tease you anyhow. Plus, I get to keep collecting quarters every time, and pretty soon I'll be able to take you on a trip to San Francisco and back.
Have you seen a quarter yet?
Yeah, but I'm keeping a tally. Are you suggesting you're not going to pay me?
I didn't say that.
Did you infer that?
Maybe.
Uh-huh.
Done, 30 to go. Some viewers have been asking if it makes a difference if it's going to be in the 80s and planting tomatoes. It really shouldn't if you keep them well watered. Sometimes, you know, you have to go on your schedule, not the weather schedule, because you can't always count on it. So it's been in the 70s, and yesterday was in the 80s here. We'll just make sure that we give them lots of water.
Well, another reason why tomatoes split is because of the inconsistent watering.
Right. Yes. So if you begin watering, then you should continue watering at irregular intervals, keeping in track, you know, the rain, obviously. But if you suddenly stop watering and then it rains, or you suddenly decide, oh, I should water my tomatoes, and it's been a long time. Sometimes that burst of water being taken into the fruit is too much for it, and it'll just split open, like if you were filling a water balloon and you put too much water in it. So just consider it. Yeah. We're gonna be planting a blueberry, and we decided it might be a good experiment to try putting one up here in this part of the garden. We just are going to make some amendments, and that is we're going to sink a pot into the ground so that we are able to control the sulfur, the acid that we're putting in. So what we've done is take the bottom out of a pot, and then we'll fill it with soil, but at the same time we're going to be adding some sulfur, aluminum sulfate, to make the soil more acidy, and that way blueberries can grow in this climate, in this geography, I should say, where we have so much limestone that everything is very alkaline.
And to satisfy Tim, we're going to be adding a lot of
peat moss. The hole is dug. The pot is in place. I'm going to start off with some peat moss. Then I'm going to add a little bit of soil. Then I'm going to throw in some of my compost mixture, and I threw a little sugar in there anyway. Can't hurt. And then I'm also going to be adding some sulfur. This is specifically for acid-loving plants. Since this is one pot and it's kind of a small pot, I'm just going to put a little bit in. I don't want to overdo. So I'm just taking a pinch and I'm going to sprinkle it on there. And let me see how big my plant is. Okay. Okay, so you can see a lot of peat moss in there. That's what it was planted in to start with. So we'll put some more peat moss in. You're right, I think I'm going to need more peat moss.
I think you're going to need a bigger boat. So you're actually making a lasagna.
I am.
Layers of soil, compost, peat moss, and
sulfur.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let me just check here. I think that'll be about it. That'll be
yep.
Good
put
for
that peat moss around it to
yep.
hold it once.
Firm it down a little bit. I think I'll put another little sprinkle of sulfur in. Some more soil. This is a tree root, by the way. Oh, good.
So for the most part, blueberries need sun.
They do. And although this is under a maple tree, it's on the south side, so there's plenty of sun coming in here. One more dash of peat moss.
Just dump it all in.
Well, I don't want to get too high, though. I don't want to go too much above where it was. But what I am going to add is a little of the azomite. Remember the trace minerals. And that should do it. Water it in nicely. And we'll see what happens with the blueberries. If you enjoyed this video, as I catch my breath, if you enjoyed this video and you would like to support our garden blog, please give us a thumbs up. We'd really appreciate you watching and giving us thumbs ups. And if you'd like to leave a comment and tell us what's happening in your garden, we would love to hear it. Join our garden family by subscribing and we'll all be one big happy gardening family. Bye for now.
Well, our neighbors are sure getting noisy.
Connect with us on YouTube.